أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
صلى الله عليك وعلى آلك وسلم.
اللهم صل صلاة كاملة وسلم سلاما تاما على سيدنا محمد الذي تنحل به العقد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد خاتم النبيين وإمام المرسلين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. طريق التصوف، The path of Sufism. قال أبو القاسم سأل: ما أخذنا التصوف عن القال والقيل، لكن عن الجوع وترك الدنيا وقطع المألوفات والمستحسنات، لأن التصوف هو صفاء المعاملة مع الله وأصله العزوف عن الدنيا. أبو القاسم said, we did not take Sufism from statements, so and so said and so and so said, and that's not what we took tasawwuf from. Because tasawwuf is about an action. It's not about just talk and rhetoric and just really deep, profound statements. I mean, you could look up Hindu gurus making all kinds of profound statements. That's not Sufism. لكن عن الجوع وترك الدنيا. We took Sufism from hunger and leaving and abandoning this world. وقطع المألوفات والمستحسنات, and cutting off familiar things that we're used to and just liking, and things that we find good, you know, for our egos and just our lower selves. لأن التصوف هو صفاء المعاملة مع الله. Because Sufism is having a pure relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وأصله العزوف عن الدنيا. And its foundational essence is abandoning this world. Now dunya, in Arabic, it's a term that's used to describe a grapevine that looks close enough to grasp, but once you reach for it, you find that it actually is not, it's not reachable, you can't get it. So it gives you the illusion, there's an optical illusion here. It looks close, and your brain calculates that you can go and get it, but as soon as you stretch out to grasp that grapevine, you find that you can't get the grapes. And dunya comes from the root word of dunu, low, that which is lowly. Now, being in this world, not all of this world is lowly, obviously. You know, knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the world is not a lowly thing. But what we're talking about is the things about this world that make you forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and start pursuing them for their sake. That's what dunya is. It's the illusory nature of this world that makes you forget about its temporality, makes you forget about what the purpose of being in this world is. That's what dunya is. And Abu al-Qasim, may Allah have mercy on him and benefit us from his knowledges in both abodes, he said that we left this world. We abandoned it before it abandoned us. Because at the end of the day, you're going to leave it physically. So he left it on a spiritual level. And it wasn't just, you know, this is a problem with in modern times and in all times really with tasawwuf. There are a lot of profound statements, a lot of things that we hear from great spiritual masters of tasawwuf. You know, like Ibn Ata'illah, for example, his aphorisms of Ibn Ata'illah, the wisdoms of Ibn Ata'illah, the hikam. or you have Hijaj al-Arus, al-Hawi li-Tahdhib al-Nufus, which Sheikh Abdul-Hakim Jackson translated to Sufism for non-Sufis, you will come across statements in there that were just so profound that when you read them, you just, wow. But at the end of the day, what did that statement do to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how did you translate that statement into action? You know, Abu al-Qasim here says, Imam al-Junayd tells us that it was about hunger and leaving the world and cutting off things that we are familiar with and we like having. Imam al-Ghazali in his Ihya, he talks about, he's got a chapter on Kasr al-Shahwatayn, the breaking of the two desires. And the desires he talks about are the Shahwat al-Batn wa Shahwat al-Farj. It's the desire to satiate oneself, to eat, the stomach, fill it up. And the sexual desire, because he identifies these as the root cause for all other ailments of the human being. And so the first thing you'll find that when you're on this path, the first thing you should look after is, how is your relationship with food? When you order a plate at the restaurant, you know, the Prophet ﷺ said that the food for one individual is actually sufficient for two people. So that one order of food, that plate of food that you order at the restaurant, let alone that, let's say you didn't order appetizers and salads and soups and all that, you know, five-course meal. You just ordered that one order of dinner. The Prophet ﷺ tells you that that one plate is actually sufficient for two people. So you can sit with your wife or with your friend and split that food down the middle and share it between the two of you. There's a hadith that is always transmitted kind of just in half, which is people say that the sunnah is to eat a third, you know, a third for your stomach, a third for your water, drink, and a third for air. That is actually the last bit of the hadith. That's not the sunnah. That's if you go extreme. That's the extreme. The sunnah is حَسْبُ بْنُ آدَمْ لُقَيْمَتْ يُقِمْنَ صُلْبَهُ. The Prophet ﷺ says, it is sufficient for the son of Adam to have few morsels of food, just few bites, to keep his back straight. Okay, and then he finishes and he says, but if you must, let's say you can't, and you just love your food, you can't stop yourself. He says, but if you must, your limit is فَإِنْ كَانَ لَابُدْ فَثُلُثٌ لِطَعَامِهِ وَثُلُثٌ لِشَرَابِهِ وَثُلُثٌ لِنَفَسِهِ. So that it's, if you must go to the extreme is a third for food, a third for drink, and a third for air. A lot of people think those thirds are actually the sunnah. The sunnah is to have just a few morsels of food, not to just keep eating and eating and eating and eating. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he was walking, when he was a khalifa, he was walking in the market and he saw this man who had a big stomach on him. And he went and he tapped his stomach. And he said, أَبَطْنُ كُوَيْفِرْ هَذِهِ. Is this a batn? Is this a stomach of a kafir stomach that you just sit there and eat all the time and fill your and get your fill? A lot of the problems that we have with obesity and whatnot is just people can't control themselves. If you can manage to control your desire for food, you will find that that will translate itself into a lot of other issues where you find difficulty controlling yourself. You know, Ghazali in his Ihya basically outlines it like this. He says it starts off with the desire for food. Once you get satiated, you will find yourself all of a sudden thinking about fulfilling your sexual desire. And so that's when you go into that second stage. The third stage after you fulfill your sexual desire is the desire for wealth. So you want to make money, you want to get money, and you want to get rich. And after the desire for wealth, what comes is the desire for power. You want to be powerful and rule over the people. Now, if you start off with the base, just the desire for food, you can break all of these other desires down. Ramadan is a perfect example. Ask anybody that fasts throughout Ramadan, they will tell you that they are feeling more spiritually elated. Usually it's related to the fact that shaitan is chained up. But that's not just it. Ask people who fast regularly throughout the year. Observe them. Don't even ask them. Just look at them. Look at their state. You'll find that there are actually people on a higher spiritual state than others. So training the self, breaking that desire, will actually help you tie down the others. And that's what being on the path is about. It's about controlling the self and getting on a path that will finally get you to have a pure relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to know something. Your body is composed of this, the soul and the physical part, right? The immaterial soul and the material body. Things that will satiate the material body will actually suffocate the soul. And things that will suffocate the material body will actually satiate the soul. So when you pray at night and you're tired, right? You recite Quran at night and you're praying and you're doing obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that tires your body out. But that improves your spiritual state. So Sufism is not about making all kinds of statements and all of these deep, profound things. You can, like I said, you can find anybody that will tell you that stuff. You can read books by Hindus and Buddhists and all kinds of figures that will tell you deep, profound statements. You can listen to an atheist, like, I don't know, you find a lot of atheists, like Neil deGrasse Tyson, who identifies himself as an agnostic, but he's got this video that went viral talking about his experience of how he sees the cosmos and the stars and how he relates to that. It's a very deep, profound, spiritual, like, it just, you feel like, wow, subhanAllah. But at the end of the day, how does that translate into your actions? How does that improve your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the test. And so it's not about so-and-so said, that scholar said, yeah, these things, if they're not translated, you got problems now. So that's what Sufism is about. It's not about statements. It's not about folkloric practices that are based on ignorance. It's not about slaughtering to the grave. It's not about any of that. It's about action so that you can have a pure relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is how you can set yourself on that path. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت
حاشا لجودك أن تقنط عاصيا حاشا لجودك أن تقنط عاصيا الفضل أجزل والموال